So first of all, thank you very much for organizing this workshop. It's very interesting to see so many different disciplines together. I will focus my presentation from a very specific angle, from the angle of water quality and the invertebrates, which are some insects which are living in the water, which give actually a kind of good representation of water quality over a longer period. So I will start with some general elements. I think most of these things you will know. If you don't, there are some references mentioned with where you can find more information about it. And I will, like previous speaker, also show two case studies. One linked to the project that is coordinated by Professor Guido Bizure, who also started this part of the presentation. But I also like to give a situation where there's a more severe impact directly reflected in the data, and that's why I also include a case study from Tanzania, from a colleague, Professor Jans. Unfortunately, there's a figure that disappeared from the presentation, but actually what is shown here, or what was shown, was like the deep sea concept, which is actually the driving forces for changes in the environment or changes in society. Could be, for instance, that there's a high request for food, there's a people like to live together in cities, or like we have here today, mining impacts. And these can actually lead to changes, to pressures on the environment, and that can lead to a status impact, a change of the status of the system, and that could finally lead also to an impact. So what is actually important, people often think about the changes in the environment at the level of states. So for instance, there's an increased level of a certain metal or a contaminant in the water system. Actually, what is very important that you look further on the impacts. In that respect, I'm very pleased that we have now a PhD student working on the field of ecosystem services, where you only look from the angle of what is now the change, the status change in a river system, what kind of elevated concentration do you encounter in a river system, and what does it mean for all different uses of this water in the short and long run. This is important to know what kind of responses are needed. Should you convince people to use less of these ores or these metals in general, or do you have to install kind of techniques that prevent that you have actually a pressure in the environment? In other words, that the there's from the mines actually something released to the surrounding environment, or do you have to clean up the system sooner or later? So, what are our typical impacts of mining? I think you can split them up in two main components. Components which you directly see on the environment, like for instance the deforestation, land degradation, sometimes also leading to diversity loss, some contamination. It's all shown here in this figure in what kind of elements of the mining this can actually mainly occur. So if you'd like to know more about this, I would refer to this paper. But also there are some indirect effects. I was talking about ecosystem service already. People start to live there near these mines. They excavate some pits, or they make some pits, and then sometimes you see that in these pits the mosquito larvae can survive, where you might have some perhaps some extra possibilities for mosquito development, maybe malaria. Although at the elevation level in Peru where we do this project, probably is not the case, but in other places it could be an issue. So you have in the process itself, you have some effects directly, but most probably these indirect effects can be higher and are also often neglected or not seen. Getting back to the case that Hugo already started, where we have here this large mine, this Yarucha mining site, where together with Hugo we had two master students, and one of the master students was somewhere else. So if you'd like to see more results of her work, it's a very limited study. It was a kind of startup study that we made. And she actually did some monitoring both of chemical conditions of the river system and also biological conditions in the river system in six sites. So two sites very close to the mine, which is our M3 and M4, and more downstream, where we have actually two references or real references. I remember when I was there together with them for looking for real references that we encountered them. We were moving around with a car to look for rivers which are still in a pristine condition, but actually they were I didn't found them driving around for one day. Why was it? Not only because of mining impacts, but actually mainly because of agriculture impacts. So everywhere you have cattle, and they also the river itself, unfortunately, and they release also some of their remaining food residuals in the river system. So that is also having an impact. So you shouldn't only blame the mine, but also all our other activities can be a basis for contamination of our water resources. So what did we investigate? So we looked at some chemical parameters, both in the water and in the sediment, but we also looked at the invertebrates. So invertebrates are commonly used all over the world to look at the water quality. Why is this so popular, using these invertebrates? Well, they typically reflect the water quality at a location, so they have a whole life cycle at that location. Whereas the problem sometimes with the chemical measurements is that you have sometimes a peak, and then you therefore need to have a very high frequency measurement. Often it's also very expensive. So that's why it's more efficient in many cases just to look at the invertebrate community composition, and they have also a typical way how they are affected by contamination. So if you have nutrient enrichment, you will see that some groups will typically disappear. If you have metal contamination, also some typical groups will disappear. And sometimes you also have negative indicators, meaning for instance if you have enrichment with organic matter, what was actually one of the cases we saw there, for instance related to that cattle that is running or walking in that river system, you see an increase of some animals which can make profit of extra energy resources in the form of that organic matter. To show you some, to give an illustration of some of the results, so here you see the two what we call reference sites, and you see clearly an increase in the contaminants in the other sites, which we think are linked to mining impacts. And then also in the wet season, we saw a very similar pattern. Here we have to be careful because the axes are different. You see a higher increase actually in the rainy season. What is quite typical in most of the countries that there is an outwash often linked to erosion from land. Here it could be that also from the mining, there could be some extra leaching from that area. So we see obviously an increase, not only in some basic components, but also in some metals. Here it's actually reflected in an enrichment factor, so it's kind of how many times more is encountered compared to the reference sites. So here you see only the sites where we expect the contamination, and we use reference sites as a basis for to calculate how much more of these metals are encountered. So you see in most of these sites you have an increase up to 5 to 10 times more. So that is usually giving a reflection of that at least a moderate to high level of enrichment with some metals, most probably coming from this mining. So how is it reflected in the invertebrate community? Actually, these data might not seem so obvious. So here, merely looking at the number of invertebrates, we see actually an increase in number of individuals in the wet season. But you might think this is quite strange because you also have in the wet season much more of typical contaminants. Why is it? Because in these conditions, usually have a higher flow of the water, so you have also more oxygen. Like I said, the impact of the contaminants is often lower because you also have actually kind of compensating effect. So usually also the life cycle is to some extent fit to survival during or being in the water system during the wet season. So if you would have a natural system, then usually you have always an enormous peak increase in the rainy season. So that's actually a natural pattern. And what is then quite interesting, that might reflect an impact of this mining already, although we have to say that the water is coming from groundwater mainly, so probably the impacts will be much higher in the future. But here we see something that is quite striking, that where you expect also that these vulnerable animals in the rainy season, that you would expect it would be much higher here. But you see in this particular close to the mine that they are actually going down. So it might be that there you have already some metals or other contaminants that are coming from the mining site that have actually an impact on these vulnerable species. So in the other things we do not see much, but as we know what is the source of the water, it's also not so surprising. But this is quite striking to find this kind of pattern already. So in summary, well, there's an increase in elevation of the contaminants. Nevertheless, so far there's not a concern for drinking water production for one of these elements. What we see is that nitrogen concentration and also other components are also affected, but most probably we think there the main source is actually coming from agriculture activities. So in the sediment there's also an increase of several of these metals, and most probably